This is Ham Radio Now, the most important ham radio program on the internet.
That's the second time today you did that.
I like that. I think anybody out there wants to challenge that, you're welcome to.
You know Marty will.
Yeah. Well, there's a story about Marty. You want to, I think I have proprietary information that I can't divulge. I don't know. I had a conversation with him. We haven't seen a Phasing Line podcast in a while. The question is, will we?
Yeah.
So we will see. It's not Martin. That's not Marty. It's Sterling. He's busy.
He's busy. Yeah. Or, it's hard.
You know, they're kids. Their interest is here, and then it's there, and Gwen is about to slap me through Skype.
No, it's okay. I'm showing Gwen where my finger is. Look here where the camera is, down here where our faces are.
Oh, yeah.
Sterling's a kid, but I think Sterling's 24, right?
So yeah, or 25 really now. Yeah, he's not that much of a kid anymore.
Yeah.
He's getting married. That could be the problem.
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Anyway, this is Ham Radio Now, episode 314. Yay. 314. And I'm going to call this one.
Kind of could be EmComm episode 11, too.
It is EmComm 11 and the EmComm Extra 11. Extra. Baker to Vegas and BikeMS. What do those two have to do with each other? I mean,
I don't know.
Nothing directly.
Amateur radio.
Yeah, ham radio, and they are events.
That's right.
They're not specifically EmComm, but they're events in that you can get a lot of experience doing them that would be directly related to your actual EmComm activity, because they're real things.
Yep.
All right. You've got some video for me to play, or I've got some video from you to play. I've got some video to play. So it's going to be all lots of video. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the program, get something out of them. Let me show you Arvin on the East Coast. There's Arvin back there. And Arvin on the West Coast.
Uh-oh.
Where'd he go?
Well, we moved the camera. Is he in?
Yeah, he's right on the edge.
All right, here. Yeah. Arvin's going to be over here. Arvin's here.
So we got multiple Arvins. We are Arvinized.
Yeah.
And so hamradionow.tv, if you enjoy the program, we solicit money. Helps. Woo. Here's what, you know, pays for all this. Not this stuff back here. That's my ham radio stuff. It doesn't pay for any of that. It pays for this stuff over here and this stuff over here. So I got to remember which button to push here. And you have a guest right there in your studio.
I do, right here in my studio. I have a guest live and in person. Gwen Goldenberg, November 6th, Golf Mike Golf, is joining us today. A newly minted ham with a new vanity call sign.
Oh, N6GMG.
N6GMG.
Going with the initials thing.
Yeah.
But staying in six land.
It was available. It was available. And the problem for me, and that's the reason I didn't stay in six land. It just wasn't available for what I was looking for. And it's growing on me, so it's okay.
And you have another prodigy, progeny. He may be a prodigy, but he's a progeny.
Yeah.
Your son.
That one. That's right. And Ian's, he's a zero as well. A zero call, at least, because it wasn't available. Something about the calls that the guys wanted in the six land just wasn't there.
So what's his call?
His call is Whiskey Zero India Hotel Golf.
Okay, another Hotel initials.
Golf. Yeah, it's all initials.
I'm going to have to change my name to, you know, like Adam Queensberry or something like that. Because I'm not going to change my call sign. It would be easier to change my name and all those records than my call sign and all those records.
Yeah, well, you have like websites and all. Yeah, you're really firmly embedded in the KN4AQ.
Yeah. And so it was good of you guys to change your call signs right away before you got established as some, you know, whatever the sequentially issued call sign was. And before you fell in love with it.
We were watching the FCC database for the initial calls to come in. just so we could go around and turn around and apply for the vanity calls.
Yeah. Cause you know, sometimes you fall in love with that first call sign. And I've only ever had sequentially issued call signs. My first one, WN9NSO, WA9NSO, and I upgraded. And I had an interim call sign that I thought, well, I'm an advanced. Let me get an advanced call sign. And I hardly ever used it. So, but it meant nothing to me. And then this one, you know, sort of, I think I got this one before the vanity program was available to everybody. I think. And I forget when that happened. I got this in 1989, so KN4IQ's been around for a while. But if you're a new ham and you got your sequentially issued call sign, and you're thinking at all about a vanity, go for the vanity right away. A lot of good reasons for doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's my recommendation. That's what we did with the kids.
So we're here to talk about a couple of events. The Baker to Vegas. We'll do that one first. That's okay. That's this thing here. They're already promoting next year.
Oh yeah, they start planning a week after the race is over for the next year's race.
And it is a foot race. Well, let's see, 120 miles of pavement, 20 stages, 8,000 runners. Oh, guests and family members and support staff, everybody all together. How many runners?
It's 290 teams. Yeah. So about 290 teams and so 20 stages. So whatever the math is on that, 300 times 20 stages, 6,000 runners, give or take.
Okay, so it's a relay race.
Yeah, it's a relay race. Nope, Every runner runs somewhere between 6 and 10 miles depending on the terrain.
All right. And all law enforcement or law enforcement associated?
The my understanding is you have to be empowered to facilitate an arrest. So you have to actually be law enforcement, like a sworn officer to run in the race.
And what will be cool is if you actually have to arrest someone during the race, during your leg of the race to make it official.
Yeah.
you gotta find a perp.
Yeah, this is definitely not a place in the desert where you want to be a bad actor.
I was just thinking what would be great is if they were to like release a whole bunch of fugitives or people who would instantly become fugitives. So here's your chance at freedom, out of jail, onto the course, and the cops are after you. Let's go.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Everywhere.
I've just given them a whole new idea for this thing. And I don't think they're going to do it.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to do it. So this was the 33rd year. It'll be my fifth and your third?
Third.
Yeah. And a couple of years, we actually had three generations of Goldenbergs work in the race. My dad, who's November 6th, Mike Golf, he came as well.
Oh, your dad's a ham.
My dad is a ham.
Is he a new ham? Or was he the original in the Goldenberg clan?
I'm the original.
Ah, so you spread it out both directions.
Actually, my dad's brother, Stu, was the original ham back in when they were in high school, but he lapsed. And so I was the first one back in the ham game. Yeah. And so there's five of the seven people that live in my house.
You're doing your part. I have taught class. You're doing your part in regenerating or continuing ham radio. Awesome.
Try it.
I've taught classes and I guess I can sort of take credit for a few dozen new hams here and there. But nobody from my family. My brother was a ham about the same time I was back in the 60s. And the other brother, who should be a ham, never got interested. So, and I have had no kids. So I can't make any kid hams.
And we have the five of us here, and we actually propagate a lot through the Boy Scout troop since I joined. More than half of the assistant scout masters that kind of work for me in the troop have gotten their tickets, and a couple scouts as well.
You're a one-man ham radio regeneration society.
We're trying. It's nothing on some of my Elmers who are doing classes every quarter. You know, they're pumping out 30 or 40 at a time. They're doing way more than I am, but we're trying. We're definitely trying.
Gwen, have you had a chance to talk much on the radio?
Do you play with it? Yes.
Did give you your own handy talkie?
I'm working on that.
$35. Come on.
No, I don't want to get her the junky one.
You don't want a spur generator?
No. You know, I'd probably get her a Woshan. I like those radios. And those are 100. They're a lot better quality.
But Gwen, so I've heard.
Gwen, I don't know, you work probably 8 hours at Baker to Vegas. And then she's done a couple nets as well.
And field days.
Oh, Gwen's been doing field days for years. But then you can work with a control operator.
My wife likes to do field days. I mean, she's a ham, but she's not lapsed, but she's not interested in doing anything ham radio-ish anymore, except I can drag her to field day in an occasional other event. She might do the next BikeMS.
Uh-huh. Does she get on the air at field day?
Yeah. Yeah, she likes getting on the air at field day.
Your mom would never get on the air at field day.
Yeah, but Cindy is KD4ACW. I mean, she's been a ham for
a long time.
That's 90, great. 92, 02, 12, so 50, she can almost qualify for QCWA.
Well, and she did code. She did with code, right?
She did 13 word a minute code to get her advanced.
Wow.
And then it immediately disappeared.
Yeah.
From her brain. Happens.
Right.
Yeah. From 92, I think, she'd be QCWA now. She's been a ham for a long time.
Yeah, I'm up to 5 or 6 letters. So I don't
know. She did. She was president of the radio club for a 2-year term. She was chairman of the Ham Fest for almost a decade and assistant for a while.
Okay.
So she put in her time in ham radio hell. But once cell phones came around and provided her an easier and more ubiquitous method of communications with everybody, then no radio in the car, no antenna on the car.
Yeah, I'm working on that for our other car, but I'm not working on it too quickly. I'm not sure she's too excited about that.
You don't have a car yet, right, Gwen?
No.
You're too young to drive, but close.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Ian asked about that. Ian's almost ready to drive, and he said he wanted ham plates, but I reminded him he's 15 and a half and he's not really studying for his license yet, so the car will come later.
I understand that the driving is not so much a thing at that generation as it was in ours, and well, yours and mine, we're staggered across two, I think, official generations. But
yeah, oh gosh, the day I turned 16, I had the appointment, I took the test, I had my license, and I was working the next day delivering prescriptions for my dad.
So, Gwen, is that true, that driving is not that big a deal?
Well, I'm kind of young, in age to, know about driving.
Okay, so you're not in a crowd of people that are are quite up there yet. You're 13?
Yeah, Gwen's 13. It'll be a while.
I forget. But, you know, Ian, 3 years to me is like that amount of time. 3 years to you is huge.
Yeah, but most of Ian's cohort, when they're 17, they're starting to drive, but hardly any of them are doing it right at 16. They've made the bar a lot higher. You have to do a lot more coursework, and then you have to have a whole bunch of hours behind the wheel with a certified driver and all this other rigmarole. So.
Safety.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll see how that works out.
And I think there's a lobby out there to pay for the traffic school driving instructors or whatever. So,
yeah.
So making lots of money.
When it is time for you to start driving, just remember that every once in a while, you need to look up from your phone when you're sending texts and see if you're about to hit somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I come up with a brain, something to invent. It's going to be a dock for your phone that's in the trunk of your car that has an ignition interlock, so that until you take your phone and dock it in the trunk, your car won't start.
Yeah, but then you'd have a fake phone that you put in the trunk, and then you have a real phone.
It's already working the angles.
They're already working the angles. I'm gonna fix this. There's gonna be something here. I think, and then it'll have to text me and say, it's interlocked. Can they drive the car? And then they can't have the fake phone there. I don't know.
Or then you could drive a block away and then just
forget it. You're not going to find a technological solution that they can't bypass.
Yeah, I know. They'll work around it. Just like I worked around all the technological solutions my parents put in place.
Yeah. My parents didn't care. Radios in the car, instantly talked on them like crazy. So, here's a picture of the route for this Baker to Vegas thing. It happens in, it was just a few weeks ago. So it was in March.
Yep.
When the weather's, I mean, this is going through the California, Nevada desert, but it's not the 150 degree desert. It's wintertime desert when it's very pleasant.
You know, the first couple of years I did the race, they did it mid-April. And the first, I think you were there for one of the years. It was like 105 during the day. And we had a lot more ambulances and medevacs go out. And so they've been moving it back. And early March is a much better time. It's, I think, as hot as it got was maybe 75 during the day. And then at night, it doesn't get too cold. So it was very comfortable. And I put on a jacket until about, I don't know, 8 or 9 o'clock.
Are they running all night?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Okay. So
they run all night. I mean, you know, it's 120 miles. If you figure, you know, they're running 6 or 8 miles an hour. It's a lot of hours, about 24, 25 hours. Most of the teams are putting in. And some of the guys, we talked to some of the guys that, you know, they go to bed and they get up at 3 in the morning to start their run. And then they run for, you know, their 6 or 8 or 10 miles and then they go back to bed.
Yes. Again, it's a relay. And I tell you what, why don't we play the video that you came up with or somebody there came up with.
Yeah, so that's my friend David, KK6DA, put together and produced that. And I'll do the tagline shot on an iPhone.
yeah, it was. Let me see if I can make this play in the right place. Now this, it has some full up sound, but it's got lots of spots where there's just some background stuff going on.
Yeah, so there's talking and there's some background too. We can talk over it or.
Yeah, we can do some narration. Let's see if it's going to pop up to the correct screen. It always does until I'm actually doing a show. And now it's not popping up anywhere. There it is.
Position 9-4, dip number 9-2, time 171453.
Safety is number one concern. Okay? We have three people that are in charge of this overall stage. We have the RV leads, we have the law enforcement lead, and we have the comm lead. And I'll be the comm lead. We have a lot of big changes this year. Changes with things that didn't happen last year. In addition to the regular ops and the ham ops, we have Rockwell Collins, who's providing communications for part of the doctor's network. We also have Verizon. Verizon is going to be over there. All right, safety. Everyone's got to wear a vest. I know I'm not wearing a vest yet, but I will be wearing a vest. Be very careful when crossing the street. Look three ways, left, right, left. You know, we were taught that as kids. A lot of these people are law enforcement officers or associated law enforcement, but they travel through here at 80 miles an hour through the stage. If you're driving on this course, you need to have your lights and your flashers on at all times, okay? Especially once the race starts. So if you're going back from here to Mile Out and stuff, keep your lights and flashers on. Do not pass. Stay with the traffic. Let's stay hydrated. We have plenty of water and so forth, at least a half a bottle an hour, if not more. We got a couple of people we've given positions to. Dean will be in charge of trailer comms. Mike will be in charge of rovers. David will be in charge of announcement. Terry will be in charge of chip timing. And Chris VHA will be the assistant comm lead for the stand. If anyone gives you a hard time, let me know. If you see any safety issues, let myself, the RV people know, or the Leos know. Okay? Again, be safe crossing this. As you can see, people are going way too fast through here.
2 meters for here?
2 meter safe frequency, yeah. With the PL of 100. So make sure you have your PL. Do not use high power, either on your mobile or when you're setting up your 220. 5 watts is plenty to 1 mile out. You don't need Yagis. You don't need anything like that. Just set up. Any questions?
We'll set up a sign-in sheet in the trailer once we get the doors open and stuff, so be sure to stop by and sign in.
Any questions from anybody else? All right, let's be safe, and if you need a vest, come and see me. We have some in the trailer. Everyone needs to wear a vest. Yes.
And we have 3 new hams here this year. And
we have 2 new licensed hams and 2 new volunteers.
Oh,
three new license hymns.
Oh, yeah. Three. Sherry, too.
Sherry.
Oh, all right. Sherry.
So, yeah, so all right, those folks so are hams, or I think there were 19 or 20 hams supporting the race this year.
Okay.
Stage. That's our command vehicle, our trailer.
1 year, we couldn't get on the repeater, and it turned out because one of the guys cranked the coax down. He just cinched it down.
My guess is that that's the right direction.
His guess?
Yeah, that's Dennis, KJ6UVQ. He was right. He was right. He's pointing back to IBEX. And that's a Verizon satellite for phone communications. They're testing out this Viasat unit. So we actually had 3G and 4G Verizon wireless out there.
No cell phones anywhere nearby, right?
Nope. No, there are no towers out there at all.
You guys, there.
This is like sheep, like,
yeah.
$20 on it.
Yeah, but it's not as good as the
Hey, whoever just transmitted, you're off frequency. You're off frequency.
There's no way he's in here.
Roger. She's always hard to find.
We have Rockwell Collins airing urgent link. HF radio system out here today, sporting Baker to Vegas. This is our radio head. It's our power source. That's all we need. And then we're using a CWA 125 antenna.
WCRT
12 by 12. Nice and compact that we can pack up and deploy out here in the field. We're set up at Med Base, Stage 8 and Stage 9, pretty much providing an option for the physicians that will be stationed out here to speak with either their hospital or back to Med Base at the medical director.
Hey, what's happening?
Our guide is, say, 1 mile out, right?
Got him. I got a good shot.
About 100 feet.
So that is 6 miles of straight road, as straight as you can get.
Down and up, and you can see the far end.
Yeah, you can see the far end. And it's a long run.
So it's almost an hour from the time you can see that first runner until they actually get there.
Yep.
Position 904, dip number 902, time 1714.
There's where I learned it was a relay race.
Yep. Yeah, you do the handoff.
Now this guy looks like he's in full gear.
Yeah. So this is a I believe this is a guy, and he's going to hand off to a female, and they're from San Diego, and they were running for fallen officers from their county, and they I think it's SWAT team, and they all ran in full gear. And one of my friends went to see the finish at the finish line. They all ran across the finish line together, all in full gear with that flag.
Position 904, dip number 902, time 1714, 53.
So tell me a little bit more about what the video was showing.
So, you know, the video was kind of compiled throughout the day, and you know, started with our annual regular safety briefing and get everybody together and tell them, you know, don't play in the road and wear your safety vest and be real careful. And you know, all complaints and challenges will go to our ham lead, Ruzy. And then we kind of start the day and we set up easy ups and tables for all of the different stations. We need a easy up for the chip timer, which isn't really a chip timer anymore. It's a camera now. When we first started doing the race, they had an in the baton, there was an RFID tag.
And this is the territory that you are in.
So if I don't know if you can zoom into that. So stage 9 is where we are, and as you can see, that straight line, as it shows in the picture, was that straight line you could see in the video, and it literally is a little bit more than 6 miles of just straight road
uphill.
Uphill
both
uphill.
Ways.
Yeah, well, there's a little bit of a downhill when you first start. I think the first half a mile or so is downhill, and then it's uphill, almost all the way up there.
I'm referring that when I say both ways, I'm referring to the what we always tell kids. You know, back in my day, I had to walk to school 6 yeah. miles uphill yeah. both ways
in the snow.
In the snow,
right? Yeah. In the snow, barefoot.
You guys, yeah, your kids got it too. Easy these days.
Yeah.
They got Ubers.
Right. No, it's daddy, but it's about Uber.
So. Daddy Uber. Yeah.
Yeah. So, so we set up, chip timing. They actually use HD camera. Now they use the webcam, the C920, like I have here. They set it up and they have the larger bibs on the runner so they can see that. And they use that for the timing. We set up,
so license plate recognition. Basically,
yeah, mostly they use it to, you know, validate the times. I'm not sure. I know that there's a QR code on the bib, but I'm not really sure they're 100% reading it. I think what they do, and I talked to the guy last year or the year before, it basically gives them, you know, a 12-hour piece of video for each stage that they can scrub back and forth for to say, oh, the runner came in here, or the runner came in there, or what color the bib was, because if you have a replacement runner, it changes from a white bib to kind of a yellow bib, and there's a slight penalty for swapping a runner out mid course.
That would be someone who's injured or exhausted, I guess.
Yeah. And so there's a van that follows each runner, and in there there's, you know, there's a driver and then somebody to egg them on and hand them waters and to be on the radio. And somebody who knows some first aid, and then there's always an alternate runner. And if they have to use the alternate runner, there's some kind of penalty involved. So they don't often do it, but if somebody really breaks down, they will sub them in.
Because that alternate has been sitting in a car, riding along, not working out. So
right,
they're fresh. Right.
They are fresh and ready to go. But again, remember each runner's only done their stage. So, you know, at the most, I think they're running 10, 12 miles at the most. And those are some of the longer downhill stages.
And this is a race. This is a timed race. There's winners.
There are a lot of winners. I don't completely understand. I should have probably sent you. If you go to the Baker to Vegas official webpage, they just posted the official winners yesterday or the day before. And there are, you know, winners from the all men's category. I think if you slide down that page, there's the somewhere in there is the official results.
Previous race results.
Yeah, it may be that one. Or maybe at the top of the page. Let's see. I don't know.
I think they would make it a big deal.
You might look at the previous race results, because that may be, they may already be thinking that's the previous race.
That's true, because they're advertising.
Yeah.
Yeah.
26 days. No, so it's not posted yet. I got an email link. I may be able to find it. But there are, if you look at the 2016 one, it'll give you kind of an idea that there's this 150 class and a 300 class. And if you go down the page, there's literally like, is it 100 pages there?
141
141 pages of results. there's all men's class, there's all women's class, there's mixed class, there's an international class. So if you scroll down the page, there are just a ton of different types of groups from all over. And, you know, there's almost 300 teams participating. So they break it down by different sections. And I've never had a really good rundown of what these different numbers are or letters are. I know there's always one overall winner, and it's either Los Angeles Sheriff's Department or Los Angeles Police Department. And that's how this started off 33 years ago. It was LAPD versus Los Angeles Sheriff's Department, and it was kind of a rivalry crosstown kind of race thing. And then it's grown and grown. There are international teams that come, Germany, Canada, Australia, you know, there's runners from all over the world come and participate, teams, you know, there.
So it's a big deal.
It is a big deal.
So at your stage, you had how many hams? A bunch.
Yeah, I think we had 18, 20 hams probably.
What do they all do? There were eight,
lots of different things. So, you know, as Rizzi was saying in the beginning of the video, they broke them down into different areas. So the area that I'm responsible for is the announce and the mile out. So we have two hams that are a mile away from the station as the runners come by, and then they relay up on 220 to us, and they write down the time they come in, and then we shadow that, write down the time that they come in. So we have two logs, and then we take those numbers.
What you were doing, right, Gwen?
Yeah, and Gwen did most of that. I think you had some downtime, but probably 80 plus percent of the time it was Gwen logging that.
Yeah, most of it wasn't me. It was just going to the bathroom.
Yeah, or dinner lunch. Breaks or resting or whatever. Hi, Lila. So
we're doing a BBC thing here now.
What's that? Great. You'll so keep an eye on it. And if her parents want to meet me, bring her in there and they can join the show too.
Great.
So that was my team, and I had myself, Gwen, Ian, and Bernard, KG6FBM. Bernard does the announce part, so he's got a whiteboard, and as the numbers, the runner bib numbers come in, he'll announce, you know, team 1, 2, 3, runner is 1 mile out, and that's their cue to get their next runner into the chute, get them ready to take the baton handoff.
Now, do you get an audience, a gallery there, or is it all volunteers and event participants of some kind?
No, yeah. So everybody that's there is participating in some way, shape, or form. So, it, you know, if you think about each team, a runner's going to run in, and as the runner comes in, they have to have a catcher, and the catcher's the person who's literally supposed to catch the runner, because some of them are literally collapsing at that point. And then there's someone to take the baton and run the next stage. And then usually there's like friends and family and other people that come along to want to see it. So, you know, at some points there are hundreds and hundreds of people on the other side of the road from where we're okay. waiting.
So that would be the gallery, the friends and family.
Yeah, that's the gallery. It's yeah. almost all, you know, friends and family and relations.
And the next runner, the person about to accept the baton, that's primarily who your information is going to is people are coming up the hill from a mile away.
Yeah, exactly.
So they can get staged and be ready.
Yeah. And they have to be ready. And it's one of the challenges is being able to call those numbers. Sometimes you get a pack of, you know, a dozen or more runners at a time. And
yeah, the video showed things pretty much one at a time, but I can see the video showed one at a time pretty well.
Okay. Hold on one sec, Gary. We're being interrupted. Sorry, there's a brief interruption. Come on in. Hi, I'm David.
Michael.
Hi, Michael.
Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Say hi to the world. Oh. We're running a podcast
You're on Facebook Live.
Yeah, we're on
to
Facebook
an
Live
audience right of probably what, three people.
Yeah. Well, welcome.
Who are these people?
Who are these people? So
my friends.
Friends and family. Yeah. This is Lila, that's the non-ham.
I'm the one who still has to take the test.
Right.
But you're going to. Yeah.
What's that?
Not quite like that guy on the BBC with the kid that came in, but.
Yes, exactly. That will be my moment.
Yeah.
I'll show you that later.
Guarantees this will go viral.
Yes, it absolutely will. And just maybe just this little snippet of that. Yeah. Sorry, I should have prepped her for that ahead of time. Next time, I'll promise I'll lock the garage
door. Just real, it's showbiz.
Yes, it is. So in the gallery across the way, so we're announcing, but when you have 15 runners come through or a dozen runners come through, it's only a mile. And so some of those guys get their last win and they've been saving it up and they want to like sprint it out. So some of them will cover that last mile in 10 or less minutes. And you've got to call, a dozen runners and make sure they get their person there to the shoot and then get them ready to go.
And I guess if they're bunched up, they can, the position can change in that last mile by quite a bit.
It will. And what ends up happening is so they keep everybody on the west side of the road until your number's called. And when your number's called, then you can come across to the east side of the road, which is the side they're running on. And then they'll have all of the runners and the catchers, the new runners and catchers, kind of staged there. And then 100 yards out, there's somebody else with an HT talking to the person who's running what we call the shoot. And they'll say, okay, runner 1, 2, 3 is coming 100 yards out. And then they'll turn and say, okay, 1, 2, 3, your runner's here. And then they put them in the chute and then they do the handoff and on they go to the next round.
So it sounds like most of your communication is local, hyper local.
Yeah, most of it is hyper local. Most of it is a mile back and forth. Now, so that's my team, right? And then, there's the team in the comm van. And mostly I think they're drinking coffee and no, I'm just kidding. They're coordinating with, so there's the main net, right? And if you go back to the map, between stage 3 and 4, I believe is Ibex, Ibex pass. Oh, 4 and 5, there's Ibex pass. Oops. And at Ibex pass between 4 and 5, that's the kind of a high spot on the mountain there. They put up towers there for a repeater and they coordinate between all of the California stage side. And then if you slide over towards...
Can you guys reach that repeater from where you are up at stage 9?
Yeah. And so when Dennis was pointing that Yagi saying, I think it's that direction, he was pointing that Yagi towards Ibex.
Bless you.
So on 16 at Mountain Springs on the other side, and that's the Nevada side, there's another repeater that they set up there. And the Mountain Springs at 16 there, they put a repeater up there on the top of the hill, and that reaches all the Nevada side. Because there's a big, basically along the California-Nevada border, there's a big mountain range, and you can't get over it unless you're on top of it. And there's no road up there, as you can see, between the two. So those two repeater kind of locations cover all of the race together.
I'm thinking, because I've been out to Vegas a bunch and talked through local repeaters. I think that Vegas repeaters, a lot of them sit up on this mountain range or ridge, but I guess they're not really usable for you?
No, because so if you look towards where we are at stage 8 or stage 9, there's that mountain range in between us, and we're right up against that kind of that backbone.
Okay, so you're not here on top of this. There's a pass there.
The valley. Yeah.
Yeah. And then this big valley, but it doesn't do you any good because
you can't
see anything.
There's no propagation.
But these guys from Pahrump and, can probably work. Well, you got your own repeater up there, so.
Yeah, they work. Yeah, they work those and they coordinate from that one. Okay.
So how much do you need to talk outside your local area to the rest of the group?
So the rest of the group, the rest of those guys, we report any major issues. We report when we're ready on station. We report when the first runner comes through. We report when the last runner comes through, and then any other, kind of tactical net stuff, people looking for this or looking for that, or they want to, know how many runners have come through, kind of at a, what count are we at?
So between you and all the other stage stations, there's a lot of traffic.
On the main net, there's a bit of traffic, and we coordinate a little bit between our stage and the stage before us and the stage after of us to tell them things like there's an ambulance coming through, or there's a bad driver on the road, or sometimes you get big trucks like wide loads or like dual trailers, and those can be challenging through the stages, so we'll make an announcement.
So this road is not closed to traffic?
Nope, it's open.
Wow.
The Walmart truck drivers hate it. that they picked that road to go on our weekend, because it slows everything down to a crawl. And
now, do they try to how do they do that? Do they try to keep one lane open and sort of like a construction zone where, you know, one lane?
If you're going, it's a two lane road. It's one lane in each direction. And so if you're going against the race, it's not so bad. Cause you know, all the racers are supposed to be, the cars are supposed to be kind of on the shoulder. Runners run typically on the, right on the edge, kind of in the quote unquote bike lane that's there. And their follow vehicles will all have yellow lights on the top, and they'll be going, 5 miles an hour. So when it's available, cars will pass them. But if you're going the same direction as the runners, you can get stuck behind a good pileup. If you've got 10 runners running all together, you can have a dozen cars kind of shadowing them.
Yeah, so that's a lot to pass. I imagine that traffic is light in general.
Yeah, on those roads in general, it's pretty light. But because it's light, the traffic, tends to go real fast. So, people expect to get through that area, really quickly. And it's a big change on race weekend, I'm sure.
Yeah. And there's not a lot of other alternatives. I mean, there's no other roads around there.
No, you take the 15 to go to Vegas. That's the main highway. But there isn't anything else, like you said. That is pretty much it.
But if you're not going to Vegas, maybe you're going to Pahrump. Where else is there to go?
Well, so if you go up from 6-7, then Shoshone, then that's the road up to Death Valley.
Yeah, I guess you could have traffic going
up
there.
Yeah, that's the road up to Death Valley. You could go to Pahrump, then you can go north from Pahrump, but it's, that's little teeny tiny towns. The town of Shoshone is, there's a post office, there's the Crowbar restaurant, there's the Shoshone Inn, and there's a gas station. And there's a couple little shops, and that's really it. It's one of those towns you sneeze, you drove through it.
Yeah, I've been through it. Cindy and I took a weekend trip up to into Death Valley in the cool of the winter. It was very pleasant, and it's an awesome place.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the time to do it.
All right. So I'm curious about, what was that, a Rockwell radio or a Harris?
Yeah, so this year there was a new addition, as Rizzi was talking about. The state of California, the county that we're in, I think it's Inyo County, added a requirement that at each stage, we used to have EMTs and paramedics at each stage. And they would, kind of catch the runner and make sure they're okay, make sure they had some water. If anybody needed medical attention, they would take care of them. And if it escalated, they would, call an ambulance or we'd call an ambulance for them, and they'd send them out. But on the California side, they added the requirement this year that they actually had an MD at every stage, and that they had to be able to communicate with the local California hospital. And as you could tell, there's no cell signal out there. And so they use these Rockwell Collins HF radios.
That did not look like an HF antenna. I was wondering, was it HF? What?
Yeah, it was HF, and I don't know what frequency it's on. I didn't get enough exposure to that. I had my 220 stuff to play around with and worry about.
Looking at that antenna, it was on a little mast. It looked like UHF practically.
Yeah, apparently. Yeah, I don't know. I'll find out, and we can talk about it the next run. But HF, NVIS. So they were where we were at the what we call med base, where they have kind of a mini little kind of MASH field hospital set up, and then they had that phone patched through the East Coast to the hospital on the California side.
To the East Coast of the U.S. Coast. Out here where I am.
Yep.
Sort of.
Yep.
Wow. Yep.
Based on propagation. And again, okay. I don't know what kind of radio I should know, but I don't know what kind of radio it was.
Yeah. Because I think, the 5 megahertz area, 60 meters type would be the regional frequency. But if they're doing something different, well, cool.
Yeah.
We need to know more about that.
I will definitely, I'll do some research. I'll find out more about that. Right. But that was a new addition. So they had those folks there. They're Rockwell Collins radios, and it worked real well. They said that they had good coverage and they were able to talk. We also had Verizon came out to to do some testing, and they brought along that VSAT unit that you saw, and it provided, I think all we had was 3G turned on, but it could do 3G and 4G. And the reason we didn't turn on 4G is I guess they don't have the ability to whitelist on the 4G, but they could whitelist on the 3G. And so if they had opened it up to 4G, everybody who was standing around would have been able to have access to that cell site.
So we made a little cell site.
Yeah, via satellite. And we did some testing ahead of time. I got a couple phone calls from folks out there standing in the middle of the desert, and it sounded great. There wasn't any delay. There wasn't any echo. It sounded, you know, crisp and clear and nice. Now, you had to be on Verizon or they had Wi-Fi. You could do Wi-Fi calling. So I'm on Sprint. We weren't able to use it directly, but I was able to get on the Wi-Fi and could have done Wi-Fi calling had I had.
So they made a little Wi-Fi hotspot.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Interesting. So I guess they're not ready to declare ham radio as the sole communications method. All these have been added. Probably at one point, ham radio is about it.
Yeah, for years and years, that's all it was. In fact, until this is the first year that they had anything other than amateur radio at the stage to communicate out. The Verizon thing is really kind of a proof of concept. And I think somebody said that, you know, you could hire them to come out to your event in the middle of nowhere and it's 20 or 25 grand for the day for that service to be out there. And so they brought it in to set it up to see, you know, what they could do and the capabilities and you know, use it as, you know, an advertising point, a platform.
And the hams are free, by the way.
Yes, we are. Oh, actually, we pay to be there.
So now,
quite honestly,
now you can... we've always pegged our value. We, you know, made up some version of monetary value based on people and hours and things like that. Well, now you can point to that thing and say, you know, here we compare to that and we're free.
Yeah. Usually the weekend costs me a couple $100. You know, we stay in a hotel, although you could camp out there, but you know, we stay in a hotel in Tacopa Hot Springs or Shoshone and, you know, meals and, you know, driving the vehicles out there and whatever other various subsidiary equipment we get, but it's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Now, is there linking and ham radio communications across the entire course from anybody to anybody, or is there only a few places it can get from one place to the other?
You know, the two mountaintops, so Ibex to Mountain Springs, they can talk to each other. The two different, there's a net on Ibex and there's a net on Mountain Springs, and the two nets, they can talk to each other. We don't talk across from our side to the other side. It's mostly relay from there because there's just no way to get there, and they don't do any cross band or cross linking.
Anything else about this setup? How many hams are involved altogether?
Oh, what did they say? I think that the number of hams they say is close to 1,500.
Wow.
Because, you know, at each stage, and then there's a whole bunch of other support that they have for the hams. My friend Jack, KO6B, does safety patrol. So he drives between several of the stages just back and forth all day long. And he's linked up, 2 meters to Ibex so that if he comes across a downed runner or a vehicle in trouble or whatever, then he can, you know, call in help or support or whatever it happens to be. The number of hams I know will take the race officials around, put them in their car. And again, they've got, you know, radios so that they can hit one or two of the repeaters depending on where they are in the course and, you know, drive the race officials around. There's a group of hams that come out pre-race, Marty Wall, we talked about him on the last couple shows. He's our ARRL vice director right now. Marty was with one of the race officials, and he drove ahead of all of the runners, making sure that every stage had the operations team up and the ham teams up and the medics up and all of the parts of the stage ready to go, that the cameras were there for the baton pass and so on and so forth. So there's a lot of hams just evolved across the board, do a lot of the heavy lifting.
Is there any point where all the hams come together at one time in one place for training or anything in advance or anything afterwards?
there's a kind of a core group.
That would be a big ham fest.
It would be. It would be totally fun if we could do it, but it doesn't happen. So there's a core group of hams that are already planning, like starting to work now on next year's race, that get together. And it's some of the stage leads and some of the coordinating people, some of the folks that run the repeaters and operations. They're working kind of all year round. A lot of those people will run the individual stages, but not all of them. And so there's no point where everybody gets together. Now, you know, we at our stage, we host a barbecue, third annual. I think this was the third annual year we hosted a barbecue on Friday night, you know, because you have to get there. You have to get there ideally by Friday, because once the race starts Saturday morning, it's hard to get by the racers and get set up in time. Plus, if you don't get there by Friday afternoon, the road to Vegas, the 15 from Vegas, once you get to about Barstow for the last 125 miles into Vegas, Friday afternoon is parking lot, bumper to bumper, just driving into Vegas every weekend. So we get up there early and host a barbecue. We have 50 or 60 people, mostly hams. Our stage, so stage 9, bunch of them from stage 8, who's another Aries, part of our Aries group, Aries Northwest. A bunch of guys from stage 7, that's the Los Angeles DCS, the Disaster Communication Service guys. Some folks from 6, some of the med-based folks come. Then, you know, we do tri-tips this year. Last year we did tri-tips. I think the first year we did hamburgers and stuff like that. So we get a bunch of them together, but there's no point where everybody comes together. At the end of the race in Las Vegas, there's kind of an official finish line. They take over one of the hotels, and a lot of the hams will from the earlier stages will drive by it all or go back around the other side and go up the 15. And be there for the end of the race, and then they have a big banquet on Sunday night and award ceremonies and what have you. And some of the folks will go there. Usually Sunday morning we get up early and head back to what I like to call civilization. head home and such.
So is that end of things the Vegas end typically handled by local hams in Vegas, or do the California guys come invade?
No, there'll be a lot of California guys there too. It's kind of a mixture, but I know a lot of the California guys that are there. I know a lot of the California guys that kind of coordinate, you know, across the whole race. Marty and Eric Christensen, a bunch of those guys will be there at the end. They're ones that drive the whole course, either in the beginning of the course or after the course, or they have some of the race directors along with them. And they'll all be there at the end.
How many years have you been doing it?
So this will be my fifth year. I missed a year. 2014, I wasn't there. So I started in, 2011.
It's about when you got your ham license, isn't it?
Yeah, shortly after I got my ham license.
Yeah. And when did you start, Gwen?
The one that we just had was my third. So...
She did the last... So she did this year and last year, and the year before that was the year I missed, and then she was there the year before that. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the year my dad came. My dad came and Ian came. There was like three generations of ham. Goldenberg's working on the race that year.
Yeah.
It was fun.
So is this something that you do just because you're with your dad, or did you say that, wow, I like doing this kind of stuff?
Both. I like doing it with dad, and I also like doing it.
There were certain points during the race we couldn't get her off the radio this year. she did hours and hours, and we know our stage is up and running. We're supposed to be on the air at 11 in the morning, and we don't shut down until about 11:30 at night. And first runners come through about 1, and of the 10 hours that we were running traffic, really, Glenn was there probably 8 hours of that 10 hours, just working hard.
I don't know how much attention you pay to the ham radio thing in general, but getting young people into ham radio is one of our problems. And so whenever a young person comes in, we want to know what it is that attracted them. And often it's probably more of our young hams coming through families, through parents that had ham licenses. But what is it about this that you like? And do your friends think you're weird? And maybe they think that anyway, no matter what.
I just kind of like doing it, like talking to people. I know a lot of the people from like the ham radio group who I've known for a long time. Pretty much everyone that I know from ham radio is very friendly, very kind. And my friends, like, they don't really understand it.
I don't think she advertises it.
Yeah.
So Baker Vegas is this third year for Gwen, but I think this year's field day will be your fifth.
I don't remember.
So Gwen has probably over 120 hours of field day under her belt. Because, you know, we're early crew. You know, field day rules are you can start setting up 24 hours in advance. And we're part of the early team. So we're showing up Friday afternoon and getting the antennas up. And we're doing security for Friday night with everything set up and ready to go. And all through Friday night, all through Saturday night, all through Sunday, and breakdown. And I usually can't get Gwen to go home. She stays the whole time.
Yeah, I used to do that. I'm too old.
Yeah, I'm getting there. This last year, I went to bed at, I think I went to bed about 2 o'clock, about 15 minutes before we made our 100 points for a satellite connection, and they woke me up yelling and screaming because they got it.
Yeah. Yeah, I used to be definitely all night long, all weekend long, and a very dangerous driver Sunday afternoon on the way back. Do the rest of the hams treat you just like one of the hams, like an adult, or do you find yourself patronized a little bit, patted on the head?
They usually treat me like an adult. I also don't really know a lot about ham radio, so sometimes I need help.
Everybody's got to learn.
Yeah.
Oh man, I came across a Facebook page. I think it was for the MD380s, the Titerra DMR, and a guy posted that he had done. There's a modification that opens it up and you put some aftermarket software on there. And a guy said, and this is DMR, is the mode. The guy said, I did the mod for the radio and everything worked, but I'm trying to listen to some P25 traffic, which is a different digital mode. Right. And I'm not hearing any. You know, I don't hear anything come out my speaker. Did I do something wrong? And clearly a new ham, didn't know very much about this mode, and he was just torn up one side and then the other. I'm really disappointed in that group of hams on that site and on that their Facebook page. And I tossed in a comment, and they said, Gary, we kicked you off of this once before. I don't remember them doing that, but I said, I hope that when I know as much as the guy that was the lead instigator of telling this guy he was an idiot. I said, I hope that when I know as much about this thing as you do, that I don't turn out to be such a jerk.
Of course, you know, it's interesting because I find, you know, the kids have been coming along for a long time, and you know, face to face, people are a lot less condescending and cruel and just downright, you know, mean. I think the nice thing that, you know, our group, the Aries group specifically, and the field day is kind of a mix of different people. I think they generally like to see the young people there. And except for a couple of the older curmudgeonly whatevers or the real heavy duty contester guys, everybody's really happy to see them there and welcoming and it works out real well. And I know enough that when the heavy hitters come in, you know, our field day ringers come in, I know enough to make sure that we're up and out of the way, and we'll let them sit down and run a couple hours to, you know, get the points going. And then once it slows down, we'll get them back on the radio.
Yeah.
But, you know, usually we're running 2 alpha or sometimes 3 alpha. So there's, you know, there's always another station to go to.
Yeah. I remember fairly clearly when I first got my general license, my novice and my general, and I was 15 years old, how little I understood about the technology that I was playing with. There's one specific memory And it's a piece of equipment that pretty much doesn't exist anymore. Back in those days, there were no transceivers. There were very few. No, very few radios that transmitted and received. We had a separate transmitter and receiver, and you needed something that would automatically switch the antenna between the transmitter and the receiver. And there was this thing called the Dow Key antenna relay, specifically designed to switch radio frequency stuff from the transmitter to the receiver. And the station that I got, I sort of inherited from my mentor, the fellow that taught me my stuff. And it had this thing hanging off the back. It did the switching, and I didn't know what it was. Simple thing, but I didn't know what that thing was. And it took a long time before finally that concept dawned on me. Oh, that's what switches the antenna from the transmitter to the receiver. Duh.
Yeah.
Everybody goes through that. Everybody has to learn. I'm really disappointed that we have so many hams that don't understand that you don't start with an amateur extras knowledge base and go from there.
And I struggle too, because I'm a general, so I know a lot more than I did when I started, and not as much as probably you know.
Nobody knows as much as I know.
No, I'm sure.
Even that guy on Facebook that ripped the MD380 guy. I know more than you do.
Tons. But it's challenging for me because I brought a lot of people in, and in some ways I'm someone else's Elmer. I'm a kid's Elmer for sure. And, in the Boy Scout troop, and it's hard for me to get people sat down and focused and whatever. Every once in a while we have some really good, training, education time, but it's challenging to get that in. And there's the easy stuff, and then there's the harder stuff, like protocol and how to talk on the radio and you push this button, but not that button. Those things are easy. And we do that along with all the things we do. It's the more technical stuff that's a little more challenging.
Yeah.
And there's also that time problem.
And Gwen, if you stay interested, if this turns out to be something that you really like doing long term, you'll be the person teaching other people not very long. Of course, you're 13. You have about 6 more months until you hate your dad. So maybe not. Maybe that won't happen. It'd be great if it didn't, but it's just statistically, chances are you'll end up there.
Yeah, I think I got a little more time than that.
Okay. Well, good.
We'll see.
Yep. So shall we go to Eastern North Carolina, the other side of the country? And
yeah, let's look at the bike race.
Yep. This is going to be very different. There's maybe about 35 hams that will be involved in this. More active participants in terms of people doing something, because there's about 2,000 bike riders in this event. It's a 2-day event. They can ride up to 100 miles on Saturday and 100 miles on Sunday. And I think I got a map.
Double century.
Yeah, I think I picked up a map here someplace. I got this wide for some perspective. Where it says Durham there, Raleigh and Durham, that's where I live. The event is down here near New Bern, and this is 1 day's worth, and this is the 100-mile course. So the folks leave New Bern, the Bern is kind of covered up, and they head out on the course around this circle. And then they, for the folks that are going to do 100 miles, they add this little extension at the end. For the folks that are only going to do 50 miles, they turn around somewhere in here. Folks can do 75 miles, they cross over here and take out this loop, and they don't do that loop. And then the 100 milers, they do the whole thing. That is 1 day's worth. I don't have a map up for the other day, but they do a different loop, and it kind of goes in the other direction, so it kind of makes a big figure eight across the 2 days. Again, with the 2,000 bikes, then the total support and family and everything swells to probably 3,000-5,000 people. All the hotel rooms fill up. There's no place to get a hotel. I just booked my hotel for this year. No hotels in New Bern are available. I got a hotel that's about 20 miles out of town and a bunch cheaper. But only about 30 hams or so. At its peak, there were about 40 hams that participated, maybe 45. And for us, I don't know about for you, for us, the number of hams drops a little bit every year. It's been harder and harder to get them. Sounds like your group is holding its own. Is it?
It's a challenge. You know, for our stage, you know, we had the 20 people and they kept complaining that we have too many and that they wanted to pull us to other stages. I know there's some stages that are further down the line. Stage 12 was one of the ones that like runs through the middle of the night, and they didn't have anybody, or they had one or two people signed up for that, and they wanted to you know, relocate some of us over there. But, you know, we're a very tight knit group. And so, you know, some of the stages are like that where they're big, and some of the stages over time, you know, dwindle. And I know they figured some people out to rescue those stages, and but it wasn't from ours.
Okay. Well, this video that we'll watch is I edited this over the past couple of days, and it is from 2012. I shot most of it in 2012, and it's just been sitting on the hard drives here waiting for somebody to do something. And when you sent your video along, I felt bad.
David's video. I had nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
Actually, I was in it, but you know.
Yeah. I'd asked you if you, a couple of weeks ago, I said, maybe you know somebody because you're in, you know, California, Los Angeles, yeah. Hollywood.
I'm in the business, but not really.
So I'm thinking, yeah, maybe somebody out there could do some of this stuff. So this is a little longer. It's about 22 minutes or so, and there won't be much opportunity to talk in the middle because it's got a lot of interviews and stuff. So we will just sit back and relax. I'll play this out for the folks on Facebook. I'll see if this makes Wirecast crash. Yeah. We'll see if that's been the problem. So let's go see this here video.
All right, y'all, let's start from 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Today is the weekend of the BikeMS. It's our 24th annual BikeMS in New Bern, North Carolina. And I'm Jeff First, the chapter president. And this is Kendall. Do you want to introduce yourself?
Yep, I'm Kendall Bell. This is my first BikeMS event. I'm the South Carolina Development Coordinator. So I primarily work with WalkMS and Challenge Walk. So this is a great experience to see all these cyclists come together. 2,000 cyclists.
Yeah, 2,000 plus. And we're looking forward to a great weekend. And thanks to Gary being here with a communications piece, we're hoping to have a great weekend.
So what's our job?
Our job is to make sure everybody is connected and make sure it's a safe ride that handles all the communication pieces, that everything is orderly, organized, and in case there's any emergencies, we do the best way we can do it and most effective way we can do it.
So it's like good luck with that.
Yeah.
and you are learning how?
I'm learning by firsthand experience in the best vehicle I hear on route. So I am observing from the best.
Rest stop 5, Dave, K4, DJW.
K4DJW, rest stop 5.
Rest stop 6, Pete, KA4SXX.
This is rest stop 6, K4SXX.
Good signal, Pete. Rest stop 7, W4XMT.
Okay. I'm in Denby, and I'm doing the BikeMS medical support and ham operations.
What does that entail? What do you have to do?
Follow the cycles. If they fall, get injured in any way, render them first aid.
In the 100 miles today and 100 miles tomorrow, how many times might you actually have something to do?
Hopefully none, but probably maybe 4 or 5 times.
And what kind of things do you run into?
Anything from just falling, abrasions, to people having chest pain, shortness of breath.
How are you equipped here?
I have an AED. Oxygen, complete first aid kit, and a foam.
And a ham radio.
And a ham radio.
And you're on a motorcycle.
That's exactly right.
How much of this do you do every year?
We do about 8 nonprofit events all over the state, and I do MS every year.
Okay, what's your call sign?
KI4ZXW.
All right, how did you get into doing this?
I worked with a helicopter for 14 years on a helicopter with East Care at Pitt County Memorial Hospital. And I've been a paramedic most all my adult life.
Are you retired?
No.
What do you do full time?
I'm still a nurse paramedic.
So this busman's holiday.
Yeah. No time off here.
I see it says you're unit 3. So who's unit 1 and 2?
Well, we have 5 motorcycles. And this is the third one we bought.
So this is a group?
Yeah.
Who else is involved?
Dr. Bill Price, myself, we're the core of the group, and then we pick up people that are motorcycle riders, ham operators, and paramedics, and we're PAs. So we purchase all this ourselves. All this belongs to us.
All right, so you're the rest stop guy here.
I'm the rest stop.
And anything happening?
No, it's been great. Everybody's been doing great. A couple of bruises, ibuprofen, but that's about it.
It looks pretty busy here.
It is. It is. It's been great. It's amazing when you see the bikes coming down the road. Just a massive wave moving towards you.
How often do you do this? How long have you been doing it?
4 or 5 years.
And do you enjoy the activity?
Oh, yeah. It's fun. Gets out and, you know, you can do something for somebody.
And you get to play with your radio.
Yes.
A little bit. Repeater seems pretty busy.
Oh, it is. All the hams are getting on it and using it very, very fully today.
What's your radio?
EmComm. And I got the Yaesu in the car in case this one doesn't read.
Go on.
So you were looking for a sag?
Yes, sir.
And it looks like you found one.
Yep.
What's the problem?
A couple people slowed up and ended up in the back. Just hit my brother and laid it down.
Okay,
back of my shifter.
Oh, okay. So you weren't injured, just mechanical difficulty and can't ride anymore.
Yes, sir.
So you're going to get a ride.
Get a ride back.
Not making you happy about that, I don't suppose.
Not at all, but we rode here yesterday, so kind of happy.
When you approached me, you had a problem. You didn't know how to find a sag.
Nope.
So how did it work? What did you do?
I just found a volunteer. You guys seem to, you know, call a couple people, take care of the situation. So.
And that would be him.
You ready?
Yes, sir.
I'm Sag 3, and this is Wally. KJ4, UKV.
And you were just asking, does anybody else need a ride? How do you know? How would you find out?
We need to go over to the captains here and find out if there's anybody else been reported.
So we could use like a bus stop or something where everybody gathers, it seems like.
We could, yeah. That'd be a good idea.
Okay.
A big flag that says, if you want to ride, you come over here to this flag.
That'd be nice. Gemini, copy, Sag 9, go ahead. Calling Doc 1, be advised that the ambulance is at rest stop 2 as we speak. Are you at rest stop 2? Negative, I just left there heading for rest stop 4. Okay, attention on that. Do I have a ham radio operator at rest stop 2 that can talk to me right now? This is Sag 8 at rest stop 2. Okay, immediately contact the rest stop captain. We have a volunteer that possibly has a medical emergency that fainted. I got a doctor en route, but while the doctor's en route, I need some confirmation on what's going on.
All right, tell me who you are, call sign.
Brian Young, KA9QJT.
Tell me about your job. What do you do?
I'm sagging bicyclists today and taking care of communications out on the route.
And how's it going today?
It's so far so good. First rider brought in at the moment. So
how do you find riders? How do you come across them?
Well, we usually keep an eye out for them on the edge of the road, and if they give us a thumbs up, if they're good to go, maybe just a flat tire, they're fixing themselves. Thumbs down if they got something more serious and they want to be picked up.
All right, and how much business do you get in a typical, is there a typical event?
Been doing this for about 10 years, and I think 2 to 3 sags a day on Saturday and about the same on Sunday every year.
What does this do for you? Not very many hams do this. Why do you do it?
It's practice, right? It's just practice to get out and use the radios in a different environment, and it beats sitting at home playing on the radio.
Okay. Show me your communication system.
Oh, all right. Well, I'm carrying a Yaesu VX7R as a handy talkie just for when I get out of the vehicle. And in the vehicle, got an IC 2720 dual band. Got a couple of the GPSs and a IC 703 10-watt HF radio in the bottom there.
Don't use any HF though.
Nope, not for today. In fact, I don't even have the antenna on the truck, so.
They should follow existing instructions as far as if they're at 6 or 7, just keep doing what they are doing. There are only 15 riders approximately that we're talking about as far as rest stop 5 is concerned.
What do you know is
we're
going on?
We've been pulled off the course because the weather is dangerous.
So I suppose nobody's particularly happy about this turn of
events. No, but we'd rather be safe. But we're all about safety.
Yeah, no, definitely.
We're fine.
We're fine.
Fine, just fine. Leave us alone.
No, we're fine.
What is the location that you're talking about?
Unfortunately, we've had to close the course. Because of thunderstorms that have come through already and what we're expecting. And so we're clearing everybody off the course and trying to do that as safely and quickly as possible. And hopefully we'll have better weather tomorrow and off we'll go.
All right, now people have chosen to keep on riding.
Yeah. What we do is some people, we cannot physically keep people from riding their bikes. So we take their numbers off and they give them to us. And we make sure they are aware that the course is closed and that they're riding at their own risk. Until they finish, and then they'll pick up their numbers for tomorrow, and we'll be back on track.
And the radio system has allowed you to do what?
The radio system has allowed us to coordinate. We have a lot of people like we do here at a church and throughout the route where we've pulled everybody off the route. The communication system has allowed us to coordinate buses, vans, and transport to get people back from these various locations on the course back to the home base.
And absolutely nobody's happy about this.
Nobody's happy about this.
You know, we can control a lot of things, but we can't control this.
So you guys have chosen to hang out here until you get picked up?
That's it. We're going to hang out here until we get picked up. We're going to be safe than sorry. That's right. We're going to be safe than sorry.
And ride some more tomorrow.
We're going to ride 100 tomorrow.
I arrived on the scene after the accident occurred, but apparently the guy took a dump and he thinks he did something to his collarbone or something to that effect, to the point where he couldn't ride the bike.
Okay. Yeah. So you called 911?
Yes, sir.
And they got here and...
Called 911, they got here. It was handled very well. Everybody handled their job well.
I'm Rick, N4VQT. And, Rick Yost.
And to my way of thinking, you have the best duty of the event.
Yes, I do.
What do you do?
Oh, the best. I ride that motorcycle right there, and I basically check to see, make sure the bicyclists are okay out there on the route.
So you don't have to pick up anybody?
Negative. No, I do have to bandage a few people up every now and then, but that's about it. I don't pick anybody up and sag them.
Otherwise, you're just riding slowly on country roads.
That's exactly right.
And talking on a radio.
Mm-hmm.
You got your bike equipped for ham radio.
Yes, I do. Would you like to look at it?
Sure.
We got a Yaesu radio out here, an FT8800, and this radio is a dual bander, of course. Runs 2 meters, 70 centimeters. The radio is actually mounted in a saddlebag here on the back of the bike, and on the back of the bike over here, I have a Diamond NR770 antenna that I run, which is really good. It's kind of like a half-wave capacitive coupled, so I don't need much of a ground plane with that antenna, and it seems to work pretty good up here in the boondocks, if you will.
How do you talk and listen?
Well, in my helmet, I have a microphone inserted in the helmet here, and I've got the speakers inside the helmet.
And it works well? You can talk as you're riding down the road?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just like I'm talking to somebody on the back of the bike. I have a push-to-talk right here on the side of the bike here. And just something comes up, I just call it in.
As I'm driving along, of course, in the car, I get stuck behind bikes. It can be hard to pass. You don't have any problem like that.
Negative.
Zip
no.
on by.
Zip right by, or I blend in with them very nicely, so without causing too much of a commotion. It works real well.
This is SAG 1. This is Kevin and N-U-A-T-Y, Bruce.
Oh, please. N-A-U-T-Y.
I'm sorry, N-A-U-T-Y.
So you guys direct all the SAGs?
Well, we at least tell them what we'd like for them to do, but some of them seem to be independent-minded.
Yes, sir. I'm at rest stop number 2 waiting further orders. You want me to head to rest stop 1 or continue on to rest stop 3?
It's the busiest job in the event, it would appear.
It is very busy. Many times we're on the cell phone, on the radio, talking to cyclists all simultaneously while driving.
How long have you been doing this?
This is my 20th year. Bruce?
15.
You ought to be better at it by now.
Well, there's just more ways to communicate with me now than there used to be.
Oh, you forgot texting.
Oh, yeah, texting, too. We're texting as well.
The event is getting bigger and bigger, more and more bikes.
That's right.
The number of hams you've got to work with seems to be getting smaller and smaller.
That's right. We could always use more hams, yeah. In fact, we could definitely use more hams, yes.
Now, you've been talking about having more and more communications channels available.
Yes.
What does ham radio give you? Why don't you just use cell phones and texting?
Well,
and Facebook.
Facebook, I hope we're able to stay off of that for a while, but there's many areas that are quite remote here on the route that normal communications such as texting and cell phones just do not work, and without the ham radios, there's no way we could cover this course.
The other thing is that having the information on a network, a lot of times another station will hear the conversation and have pertinent information. If we were on cell phones, they wouldn't hear that conversation. And that saves a lot of time and often makes a crucial difference.
In the town of Oriental, along First Avenue,
I'm Dan Sears from Chapel Hill, North Carolina.
And you seem to be particularly well equipped here.
Well, we built the thing especially for these events because that's what the wife and I like to do. And it seems to come in handy and gets the information back.
So what have you got? What did you put together?
We put together a 5x10-foot trailer, and we've got a UHF rig in there and VHF rig, and a generator to run it, and that's about it.
So relatively simple.
Yeah, absolutely simple, because the simpler the better, less things to go wrong.
But it provides you shade and shelter if it rains.
That's correct.
And what else?
And a place for people to gather.
It's a social event.
Well, sort of a social event, but you know, the hams can come here. There's a central point for information. It's pretty visible. Everybody knows where it is. The doctor is hanging out around here. He can monitor the frequencies and hear what's going on here, hear if his services are needed. The other hams, we've done some medical things at the beach to battleship last year. We were just overwhelmed with hypothermia cases, which we weren't expecting at all. And I was able to, you know, heat the trailer up and pack some people in it and warm them up. So it was acted as a shelter not only for us, but also for the riders. I try to be as ready as I can, and I feel by doing these, I have a greater degree of confidence that I am ready. This generator runs. I know that this generator is going to start on the first pull because we use it all the time out here.
Not just once a year at field day.
Not just once a year at field day, no.
Like mine.
But we use it every weekend. Do I really need the generator out here? Maybe not. But that's part of the deal, is to exercise it, keep it running, and that way I'm confident that it'll start.
Okay, so maybe somebody doesn't want to get into it quite as deep as you or me. What can they do? Should they? There's still a place for them?
Absolutely, there's a place for everybody. We needed some extra hams here, and they don't need to ride around in the car. They don't need to make a huge investment. A mobile radio, a simple antenna. That'll get them going if they don't want to spend the money on gasoline. I understand that's expensive. Times are tough. But you can come and man a rest stop. You can volunteer at the start-finish line. You can run a SAG. There are lots of opportunities to do this and exercise your gear. You'll become a better operator. You absolutely will.
And when the chips are down, you won't be deer in the headlights. You'll have an idea what to do.
Absolutely. You've done it before, or at least you've done something similar. And not only that, there's one other benefit. By coming down here, by going to Wilmington, by going to Raleigh, by going to Chapel Hill, you get to work with different operators. You work with different clubs. You work with different people. Everybody has their own style. This net control here has a different style from, say, John Snelling or the folks in Raleigh. They do it differently. But if we have a big one, and I hate to keep going back to that, but let's hypothetically say we have a big one. Who knows who's going to be called in from across the state, and you're going to be answering the radio. Who knows who's going to be running net control?
How did you learn how to do what you do?
Coming out and doing it. That's it. Being stupid the first time, being stupid the second time, but less stupid. And some people will argue I'm still stupid, and that's okay.
Well, welcome to the new and probably permanent homepage video here at hamsexy.com. It's not often that we run into a whacker vehicle out here in the wild, but we've come across one. And meets all the criterion. Look at all those antennas. Got to count eight antennas, and of course he's got his flashing light going. Well, it doesn't look very permanent, but he's probably always got it there, and he's got his signs, bike rack, great big antenna. Yeah, let's see what he's got for radio equipment. Windows open. Oh, yeah. Yeah, this is a whacker. That's a pure police vehicle setup. That mount and all that stuff. All those radios. What self-respecting ham needs that many radios? He's probably got like six handy talkies on his belt. So, yep. It's a whacker vehicle extraordinaire. Let's see who that guy is. Maybe he's got a ham plate. Oh, he does. KN4AQ. And he'll be proud to occupy this prime position on the homepage of Ham Sexy. Oh, wait, I think I see him coming. Hold on, I gotta hide. Yeah, look at that. Got the vest and all the handy talkies. Whacker Supreme. All right, well, go check out the rest of hamsexy.com.
Darn it all. I think, as you've noticed, we've had a couple of crashes on this program, and I am now post everything. I've got the program all edited, and what I have to tell you is that in one of those crashes, we lost footage that I could not recover. It wasn't critical. There wasn't anything that we talked about that you absolutely had to know about. Except it contained some impromptu acting and singing by Ian Goldenberg, David's son, who stopped by the West Coast studio.
Dear God, I realize, of course, that it's no shame to be poor, but what would have been so bad to have a small fortune? If I were a rich man.
All right, let us finish the show. If I were a you can pull up a chair. There's a chair over there.
I created a monster.
I think he's leaving.
He's making his big exit.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ian. Ian, you are awesome. And that footage is gone. Well, I should explain a little bit about the Ham Sexy. I mean, that's been a group of guys that have made fun of whackers, what they call whackers. Mostly hams who see themselves in an EmComm role, but kind of wish that instead they were in the first responders, the police department, the fire department, whatever. So if you've got a bunch of antennas, if you've got a bunch of handy talkies, if you've got a light bar on top of your car, the Ham Sexy guys are going to think you're one of those. And a very few hams are like that. Most of the folks involved in EmComm, not like that. I have the light bar because I realized after driving down country roads with just my four-way flashers on that the guys with a light bar were way more visible, sitting on the side of the road helping a bike. And traffic moving fast, you could see them and notice them a lot farther away. So I got the light bar, and I'm happy that I did. And so I thought I'd make that little video at the end just to say hi to the guys over at Ham Sexy, who, by the way, have not updated their website since sometime last year. So maybe they're losing interest, too. All right, let's get back to the close of the program. David from yesterday, because I'm recording this the next day. David from yesterday, let's wrap things up.
You know, the best part for me is the public service. There are so many hams out there that are doing so much, you know, community service and involvement. And I think that's that would be my real message for this show.
Yeah, that's one of the things that in my video I mentioned and talked to a couple of people about, and in general is sort of an issue for me, is that not enough hams participate in these things.
Yeah.
And well, you guys have had great participation, probably still not as much as you could use. And you get a lot of hams at the club meetings and at ham fests and stuff, and of them, only a very small fraction do this stuff. And I don't do it because I think it's really important, but it's, you know, it's like drudgery. I do it because it is a heck of a lot of fun.
And, you know, it's the same thing for me. You know, if you think about Baker to Vegas and, you know, I take a day off work, we drive 200 miles, you know, we put ourselves up in a hotel for two nights, and it's really because we have a great time. We have a lot of fun. And there's a lot of camaraderie. You know, I get to bring my kids along. Although I'll tell you, the first year I wasn't really sure it was going to work out very well. but they have a great time. And you know, like you said, it's just a lot of fun.
Yep. And I'm glad your kids are getting involved.
Yep.
And they seem awesome.
Yeah, I have good kids. I'm lucky.
And that's the first time we've had a play staged right here on Ham Radio Now.
Yeah, that's right. Is that gonna hit the cutting floor?
No. That stays.
Oh, good.
Because it's acting.
That's right.
I like acting.
Well, you know, I had in my Facebook feed come up this morning, and I promised him I wouldn't share it from 8 years ago. Ian in his first guitar solo singing a song that he made up for Daddy Day Camp. We used to do Daddy Day Camp during the summer, because I was out of work for 2 years after the bank crisis. And he wrote a song for me and for us, and it was a lot of fun. And he tells me every time I bring it up, he's like, I'm going to find every copy of that and destroy it. I said, no, it's on the web. You can never get
rid of it. Good luck at that. All right. Speaking of wrapping things up, we weren't speaking of that, but let's speak of that now. Yes, there's your Arvin. Here's mine. I guess he was in the picture, wasn't he? Yeah, he's still there.
Yeah, I think mine wasn't because I moved out, but I don't know.
Yep. So I was asking the last show if you know the drill yet, or can do the pitch. You could probably tell me you won't do the pitch because you're not making any money off of it yet.
Yeah, I wasn't going to say that. But if you like the show and you want to support us, please check out the link on Ham Radio Now. If you click on the website and click enter and then you go to the bottom of the page, feed the pig. That would be what Marty would say, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I remember something that they brought up at a previous show that I thought was great. Starvin' Arvin.
There you go.
Feed the pig. HamRadioNow.tv is the website. I'll let you in on a dirty little secret. If you were to do HamRadioNow.com, you'd still get there.
Would you still? Okay. You got it all covered.
Yeah. I actually, when I was starting things up, it was just going to be HamRadioNow.com was not available. And I found the guy who had it. He'd been intending to start a show called Ham Radio Now. Mm-hmm. And he had it for a while. And then he said, I'm not sure how I found him. But he said, I'm not going to do it. So I'll let it go. And, so he let it expire and I picked it up real quick. Uh-huh. And you know, he didn't try to sell it to me or anything. He just gave it. Now he's going to try to do a show. He's recording some stuff to do his own show.
Okay.
And I'll promote the heck out of it once I find out that he's actually done it.
And whatever he happens to call it, but other than Ham Radio Now.
Unfortunately,
I'll admit, I think I go to hamradionow.com every time. I'll have to work on the .tv.
That's a twit thing. Because they were doing the .tv, and I thought, it's a TV show. Although these days, as I look at the records, a typical show will get 1,000, 1,500 views on YouTube, and the audio is catching up now.
Oh, good.
Several shows have crossed the 1,000 mark in terms of audio downloads. And I think that they get played more fully than the videos do because people can do them at their leisure and on the road. So that's cool. So we should mention that I always forget to do this in the promotional part of the program. We're an audio podcast.
Yep.
So if you've got a phone, you know, one of these slabs of plastic, and you got a podcast app on it, you should be able to find us just by typing in Ham Radio Now. Sometimes you might need to put in the separate words, Ham Radio Now. Sometimes it'll get as one word. I'm not sure why I do the one word. I guess it's because you can't have a web address that is three words.
You can't have the spaces in the web address, right?
Yeah. So everybody does a name with three words together. You capitalize to separate them out.
Yep.
So I'll warn you
if you're listening to this episode on your phone, audio, you missed a good stuff. There's some awesome video.
Yeah, I put in the description of a program that goes on the audio, I will give these programs a radio rating.
Okay, good.
And if it's just us, you know, talking heads.
Yeah, that's just fine.
Yeah, then I'll give that a radio rating like A. And if it's, you know, if it's just got a few websites that I've tossed in, maybe I'll make an A- or something. Mm-hmm. If there's video material, but it's not that important, you know, down to a B. If you really need to see the video to get the whole gist of the episode, then it could drop down to a C or a C-. And if there's no sound at all, it would take an episode that is all picture and no soundtrack, then it might get a D or an F. I don't know. Look for the radio rating, but almost all of them. And when I listen to them as audio, even the ones that have been mostly picture like this one, or they have a lot of picture in them, they still translate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The Baker to Vegas footage, probably not so much because there's a lot of music and there's a lot of like watching people running across the line.
But we were talking, so.
Yeah, yeah. There was some talking in that. And I don't know, for the rest of your video that I didn't get to see, there's a lot of, you shot that one like a show. There's a lot of talking and interview stuff like that. I need to work on my interviewing in the field skills and whatever. I'll get there.
I shot that in 2012, and and one of the, for those of you that do watch the video, you'll see that most of the interviews are done with people's faces right up in the camera, because I didn't I was driving a shadow sag wagon. Mm-hmm. That was my job, and the video was I just snuck it in when I didn't when the guy I was shadowing, which was Jeff First, who was the chapter president that year. He would get out at a rest stop and he'd go meet people and, you know, thank them for helping and participating, or he'd be handling a situation of some kind. And at that point, I could stick my camera in people's faces and talk to them. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't bring the microphone and the tripod and all that stuff, and things are loud. So this is a tip for people who shoot video with little handheld cameras. If you want to get good sound, get them up close, within a few inches. I had to be that close. You don't have to have... Now, everybody's got a giant nose because I was really close, you know, cutting off the top of their head and all. But that was just because all these locations were noisy.
Right.
If your location is quieter, you can get back a foot or three. But you don't want to be back 10 feet because then it'll sound pretty bad. So it's a little professional video tip for free. From Ham Radio Now.
Awesome. All right. Awesome. A lot of fun today, Gary.
Time to go. Cindy wants to do dinner.
Okay.
7:30 on the East Coast.
Yeah, you should do that. I got to start barbecuing too.
Yeah. Ooh, can we come over?
Yeah, come on down. I got plenty of food.
We'll be there in 8 hours.
All right, you got it. There'll be leftovers.
Actually, if we can book a flight instantly.
Yeah.
It'd be that long. Someday I'll be out there. Someday.
Okay.
All right.
We'll barbecue then.
You are.
I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. It's your turn.
Over
and out.